Welcome to the show, sir.
Thank you,
How are you?
Dr.
How are
Sundar.
you?
I'm good, good. So sorry for, I don't know, the technical glitch
No,
from
no,
my
sir.
end.
These are technical errors we cannot avoid. These are new things, right, sir, for all of us.
We are all learning.
Yes, sir, definitely. So, sir, without much further ado, we'll get in right into the topic. The topic for today is current status of medical genetics in India. So, sir, before we start into delving into the topic, sir, for the benefit of the viewers, we would like to know, sir, what is medical genetics?
So, medical genetics is the discipline of medicine where we diagnose and manage hereditary or a genetic condition. So, it is like any other specialty where we diagnose and management, yes, very little, minimal, but yes, a lot of things are there which is coming up and a lot of things in prevention.
Definitely, definitely, sir. Sir, as an MBBS student, we always think of certain, we think of doing our PGTs in certain topics like surgery, medicine. So, sir, I'd like to know what piqued your interest in this subject, sir, the medical genetics.
Okay, it is a little strange. So, so basically, after MBBS, one of my friend happened to show me about this University of Glasgow, and then there's a medical genetic course. So that time we had a very limited Google and all those things. So, but we happened to get hold of this course, and it fascinated me. And that time, like we read very limited that the gene therapy will help in the treatment of the coronary artery disease, how a gene can open up the clots, all those things. So that fascinated me. So, and then this was something different. And then there were, even that time also, there was a lot of saturations in the specialties and all those things. So this fascinated me. We just I just took that decision to go ahead with this. To be
Right,
honest, I
sir.
didn't know what is genetics and what is happening about genetics in India even in that point of time.
Definitely, and thank God, sir, you did. And so now we'll delve right into the proper topic. So, sir, what are the most common genetic disorders in India, or what you come across in your day-to-day practice?
Okay, so in day-to-day practice, so we all started, okay, with the genetic disease mainly on basis or promoting or educating about Down syndrome. That was the one of the primary thing. And then apart from Down syndrome, spinal muscular atrophy, Duchenne muscular dystrophy, beta thalassemia. So these are the common genetic condition what we see. So these are the some of the common conditions which we see, but there are a lot of genetic conditions. These are one of the few commonest conditions.
Right, sir. So, sir, as you have mentioned, so one of the most common diseases in India is beta thalassemia. So, sir,
Yes.
almost 10% of the thalassemia cases globally are found in India. So, sir, lifelong blood transfusion in these cases becomes a hassle for the patient as well as for the family, sir, with problems like hemochromatosis or things like that. So, sir, what role does genetic medicine play here?
So genetics play a very crucial role here. So first two, as you are saying, you are telling lifelong blood transfusion, and then if at all bone marrow transplant again, which is
Right.
very costly affair, and it is not easily available, and the donor has to match, and all those factors. So what we know is the prevention is the better. So the hemoglobinopathy or beta thalassemia among them, the incidence is very high. So
Yes, sir.
we the carrier status of beta thalassemia, which is autosomal recessive condition where both the
Yes,
parents
sir.
are carrier. So the carrier frequency itself is somewhere around 3 to 17%. And if you ask some of the hemoglobinopathy like HbS, sickle cell, HbE,
Yes,
which is
sir.
very common in the northeast part of
Right, sir.
country, and
Right.
that goes somewhere near up to 40% also. So you have to understand the
Okay.
carrier risk is very high. So the only thing is that how early we can identify and prevent this. So that's the reason now we are emphasizing on all pregnant ladies to, whenever they are coming for the antenatal checkup, first checkup during that time, along with the
Right.
routine blood investigation of CBC and other thing, we
Right.
are recommending HbE electrophoresis. Because as you know, in India, the Indian women are anemic. So it's very common. So
Definitely.
we need to find out, is this anemia, is it because of the beta thalassemia carrier, or is it because of the nutritional anemia? So we
Nutrition.
always recommend HbE electrophoresis. Once we identify that the pregnant mother is a carrier, then we need to check the other part. And if
Right.
he is also carrier, then they are at 25% risk of developing a thalassemia major. Then we
Yes, sir.
need to investigate at the gene level. Because you have to
Right, sir.
understand, the beta globin gene, there are more than 100 mutations are reported in literature. So mutations are nothing but the change in the genetic position, gene position. So which will give rise to abnormal protein formation. And with this abnormal protein formation, the baby will have anemia and all other factors, primarily in
Yes.
thalassemia, the low hemoglobin. So we need to identify at the molecular level. Then we can offer a prenatal diagnosis at 3rd month, as early as 3rd month, that is around 12 weeks.
Okay.
And check the fetus, and check the fetus with the molecular level, because we cannot check HbE electrophoresis in the fetus. So we need to identify defect at the molecular level and check the fetus. And then we can inform the parents about the status of the fetus. So like that, we
Right.
can prevent thalassemia.
Okay. And many other diseases similar to that, sir, like
Yes, similar. Yeah.
right, sir. So, sir, as you have also mentioned, sir, so it has been seen that, sir, amniocentesis can detect a large number of genetic disorders before the birth of a child. But, sir, as we know, it's invasive, and there is also a risk of abortion due to amniocentesis. So, sir, do we have any other technique by which we can detect these genetic disorders before birth?
Yes, there is a technique which is available, which is what we call as an NIPT, non-invasive prenatal testing. Okay, so what is in this test? It is like any other testing, like double marker testing, which is done primarily for Down syndrome. So it is from the
Yes, sir.
mother's blood. So what we know,
Okay.
in the pregnant mother, 5 to 10% of her blood has a placental DNA. Placental DNA from where the fetus is growing. So we can extract from that placental DNA and sequence along with mother DNA, and some algorithm goes into it, and then we can give
Okay.
the risk for Down syndrome. Okay,
Okay.
so it is the non-invasive. There is no risk of abortion, but it is more accurate for Down syndrome. 99.2% or something is accuracy for Down syndrome,
Down
not
syndrome.
for the each and every conditions. So if you have other, suppose some structural defect or the high risk pregnancy, okay, so then if the risk is less than 1 in 100, then it would be advisable to do amniocentesis to take the
Okay.
fluid out of the mother's womb. It's a USG guided procedure. The risk of abortion with the experience and trained hand is very small. It is less than 1 in 300, that is less than 0.5%. But there we can look at lot of other defect at the chromosomal level, or if there is any specific ultrasound finding is there, then maybe even at the gene level also. But another important factor in this all this prenatal thing, we need to understand that all this workup has to be completed as of now before 20 weeks.
20
As you
weeks,
are
yes.
aware, the MTP Act allows only termination till 20 weeks, After that, you have to approach a court and then take a special permission. So this act has been amended, and the bill has been passed in the Lok Sabha, and we are awaiting Rajya Sabha. Hopefully, in this session, it will be passed. So we'll have a lot of breathing space for another 4 weeks, where we can decide about the pregnancy at 24 weeks. So we need to finish all these things. So all these tests as a plus point of timing and limitation.
Right, sir. So, sir, as we have, as you have said, that it's all basically diagnosing the conditions, right, sir? So, now, sir, as we have also seen that there is a declining trend of infant mortality rate in our country. So, sir, basically, due to this, the importance of preventing those birth defects becomes very crucial. It's not just sir, diagnosing it, but also preventing it before it occurs, right, sir? So, sir, how, sir, can you give some measures to prevent those birth defects before it occurs?
Okay, so you have to understand the birth defect, the cause, it is multifactorial. The cause of 50% of birth defect cause is not known, and 50% where the cause is known. Again, the 50% in the known cause accounts for the genetic cause. So around roughly 25%, we know it is because of some form of genetic origin, either at the chromosomal level or at the gene level. Now, so there are different way we can do. As you said, likely, like no, the infant mortality rate is decreasing. So
Right.
that way, the more importance is being given, we need to give for the genetic conditions. So there are different ways of doing diagnosing birth defect. If it is pre-pregnancy, you can do double tests and quadruple tests, screening for Down syndrome, and as I told you, before pregnancy for hemoglobinopathy, identifying those things. And then after birth, if you want to do the newborn screening we should
Right.
do, and that is for the we can do from the common 7 conditions to
Okay, sir.
appropriate 40 to 50 conditions. So that is from a baby's heel prick. Okay, Duncan, this Guthrie test, what we call. So from the baby's
Yeah.
heel, you take a heel prick and then screen for like around 50 metabolic conditions. And this has to be preferably done within after 48 hours. And if we identify any of those conditions, then early detection and diagnosis can facilitate life-saving treatment, which can prevent the progression towards disability. So those are certain conditions where we have some form of treatment, or you can control the progression to disability.
Diseases. Right, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, actually, sir, what can we do? Like, what counseling can we give to the couples who are trying to conceive so that they do not conceive children with birth defects, like the prenatal counseling, or even like we can sit down the couples and give premarital counseling so that they do not have these birth defects in the future. So can you say
See,
something about that?
yeah, so you have to understand the premarital counseling, what you mentioned, that we do usually when in particularly in South India, you know, there's a consanguinity is there. Okay, so
Right.
we get a lot of time people coming, different families coming for the they want to get married, so they want to understand about the science about it. So that time we do premarital counseling. We take detailed family history to 3 to 4 generation, minimum 3 generation, to understand is there any genetic condition running in the family, and then tell them about the different autosomal dominant, autosomal recessive, X-linked recessive inheritance, and all those things. And we say that if there is one notion is there that people who marry within relation, they are only at risk. It is not like that. When you marry within relation, chance of having a genetic condition increases. But when you marry outside, it doesn't mean you don't have risk. So as a geneticist, we will never say any condition that you are at zero risk. There is always a risk. The risk may be low.
Risk.
So because we, as I told you, like hemoglobinopathy, autosomal recessive, so many conditions are there where you can be a carrier. So we carry 6 genes in recessive form. So the only thing is that the other partner may not carry the same recessive gene. But when you marry within relation, carrying the other partner because you are sharing the same genetic pool, the other partner carrying same genetic carrier status increases. So we advise, to, as I told you, that is for premarital counseling. So they have to decide upon that base. If there is no history, so we say family history of any abortion, neuromuscular disorders, or any intellectual disability, then we say the risk is slightly higher than the population. And the other thing what they can do is once they get married, then we have certain tests to screen for around 500 genes to 2000 genes of common autosomal recessive conditions. Okay, so you have to understand that end of the day, there is nothing called 100%. There is always a small risk. We need to understand the condition or the risk and go ahead. And if you have test, we can do those testing. But nothing is 100%. So we need to understand all those things. The other thing what they can do is doing this Down syndrome screening, double marker test, syndrome, which is very important, which is very highly, detection rate is good when you combine it with a good ultrasound during third month, which we called as a nuchal transfusion C scan, which is nothing but the back of the neck of the baby, which is a very good marker for genetic condition. Chromosomal abnormality like Down syndrome and other conditions, even genetic condition, single gene disorder also. So with this, we can get some idea. And the good third month, around 16 to 18 week anomaly scan, looking at the baby's anatomical, all the brain and the kidney and everything is okay or not. This is one thing. And as I told you, after birth, the newborn screening and maybe the extended screening for tandem mass spectrometry for around 550 conditions and all those things.
Right, sir. Sir, can you please elaborate on the newborn screening, sir?
So newborn screening is nothing but you look at the heel prick and test as I told you, common disorders like hypothyroidism, congenital adrenal hyperplasia, galactosemia, GPCPD, cystic fibrosis, phenylketonuria.
Storage disorders.
Storage will come into, we have to be very specific at that is at the gene level. So we need to be very specific unless we have clue. So as of now in India, we have not started all those things because that will require a lot of testing at the gene level. So these are like at the heel prick level. So it gives the common condition. So again, you can debate how many tests to add. So that is always challenging. Right. Each test has a cost. So where you want to stop. So you are saying you add double marker test, you add hemoglobinopathy, you add for all this NDS. Again, this can extend to another 50 condition where around 40 to 50 inborn error of metabolism. So there we can do all those things. So, and then you have to understand there are any tests, there are plus points, there are negative points. As I am telling you, it's newborn screening. That doesn't mean it is a diagnostic test. It is just early detection, which from the population, which can go into next level of testing, diagnostic testing. So, and then there can be a lot of false positive because of the premature baby and low birth weight and other factors are there. So all this need to understand, but this helps in preventing certain condition, as I told you, identifying them early.
Early, right, sir.
Right.
So sir, another important condition in our country that we can see in the children are autism. So, sir, does autism have any genetic component to it?
Okay. Now, autism is a multifactorial condition. Okay. But you have to understand genetic is one of the components. And the proportion of genetic causes or etiology is increasing. Now, what we know, around 50 to 40% has some form of genetic etiology. Okay, so the autism and genetic is the incidence is increasing. Another thing you have to understand, according to CDC, the incidence rate, prevalence of autism is 1 in 54. Okay, that is very, very high. Okay, now with lot of awareness and all those things, we're able to educate common public and the clinician about Down syndrome, which has an incidence rate of somewhere around 1 in 700 to 800. So can you imagine where is 1 in 700 and where is 1 in 54? So autism is again increasing, the incidence is high, and there is a strong genetic association. So there are different testing available for autism. Okay. So early, so they say autism, if you pick it up, for that matter, any condition and particularly genetic condition, if you pick it up early, you can help the kid. Okay, so it can be picked up as early as, like, you know, when the baby is not recognizing the social smile, and then they are more focused towards the object, and then the babbling is not happening around 6 months to 1 year, and they are not able to follow your finger thing. All those things are the early, what we call it as a red flag. Okay, the other thing what we little later what we see is the speech delay. So these are some of the early clue which we can get from autism. So another thing, see, if you pick it up early, then you can help them with lot of this speech therapies and other language therapies. So which is sort of a help to the children. So there are certain tests to find out the cause of autism or genetic etiology, like chromosomal microarray. Chromosomal microarray is nothing but checking the chromosome. Checking the chromosome at the higher resolution. So we can check the chromosome roughly 50 to 100 times higher resolution and check for all the small point deletion, duplication, which cannot be picked up by the conventional karyotyping. Then you have to do Fragile X screening. Fragile X, again, is one genetic condition where we have intellectual disability and then they have infertility and other thing. But milder form of Fragile X, full Fragile X syndrome, can mimic like autism. So that is another test what is recommended. Then if you further want to do, you can look at the IEM screening, then at the gene level. So you have to understand more than 100 copy number variation, that is deletion duplication has been reported, and more than 1,000 genes have been reported with the autism. So there are multiple tests you have to do for autism to understand the etiology of the autism. And obviously the therapies. Therapy is important. Diagnose it early and help the kid with the therapy.
So are diseases like Rett syndrome being misdiagnosed as autism? And where you come in, sir, like as geneticist, you can diagnose the Rett syndrome?
Yes, no, Rett syndrome we can diagnose. So what you, and it's not misdiagnosed. So you have to understand, as I told you, autism, Fragile X is very prominently, is more commonly associated. Similarly, Rett also can present as a autism. So it's a wide, so you have to understand, autism is now called as autism spectrum disorder.
Disorder, right, sir. So yeah, it comes under the spectrum.
Yes, so Rett, when you have a female with the behavioral issue, you need to screen for Rett syndrome. So that will be an additional test if it is a female with suspicion for Rett autism. So that one, and then definitely we have test, as I told you, when I said 1,000 genes are there associated. So in that, MECP is one of the gene, which is one of the gene for autism also. So MECP2 gene is for the Rett syndrome. So we can definitely identify the Rett syndrome.
Right, sir. So, sir, so what can you tell us about genetic testing? It is one of the things which also interested you in your MBBS days, sir.
To be honest, MBBS days, that was long back. So genetics in our time, I think more or less it is not changed that much. It was part of first MBBS 16 mark question for the genetics, along with genetics, the embryology and I think histology and all those things. But yes, genetics, but in today's time, it has to be definitely more. So that one common challenge we always, now also we are facing, maybe a little better off. But whenever you talk about any condition, the first thing is not the diagnosis. First thing, the patient or a lot of people ask the treatment, which is not correct, which I tell everybody, for any condition, you have to like, you know, what is the current condition, what we are facing, pandemic. So we need to diagnose it. It's not that just like any other flu you say and then start treating like COVID. So same thing applies even in genetics. But unfortunately, the second part, that treatment, is little minimal in genetic condition. So that's what I'm trying to say, the testing and diagnosing is still important. So, but again, genetic testings are costly compared to routine testing. But I won't say that costly. But if you consider some of the high-end testings of regular medicine, MRI and some other thing, this is also quite not that costly. Now, another thing what I want is the testing. There are different testings are there for understanding the different etiology. When we say genetic testing, so one is, if you want to explain, it is in the macro level, is chromosomal abnormality. So looking at the chromosomes, numbers, and deletion, duplication. So you do, if you are suspecting Down syndrome, Turner syndrome, all those things. Okay, so it's simple karyotyping would be enough. But if you are looking at intellectual disability, behavioral issue, other thing, dysmorphism, then chromosomal microarray is a must. That is recommendation. And then the other testing is at the gene level. Now, gene level testing, now we have a new technology which is called as a next-gen sequencing, NGS, where we can sequence multiple genes together. So we can sequence the whole genome also. Okay, so it is comparatively very cheap and comparatively fast. But like, you know, what is the, if you are looking for a cystic fibrosis, then we know only one gene to be checked, CFTR. So you can do like that. If you're looking at achondroplasia, which is like a short stature and all those things, that you require only one mutation. So again, in molecular, this can be further divided from starting from PCR testing to Sanger testing to NGS. So these will detect the point mutation, and then something, another test, what we call as a deletion duplication. So there are different types of tests is there. So we need to understand what we are suspecting, what tests we need to do, what is the limitation of those tests. Everything needs to be understood. So what we say, always counseling is very important. Pre-test counseling, post-test counseling, all those things are very important. So the other thing what I want is, like, you know, the why the genetic testing is important, the importance, what you ask. So you have to understand, when you do this testing, or when you get the diagnosis, so it will, like, you know, end the diagnostic battle, or it will avoid the inappropriate, costly, traumatizing test, because you are not able to diagnose. You are doing a blood test, urine test, CT scan, MRI, and so many testing, but you are not able to diagnose it. So once you diagnose genetic condition, you are going to end all these things. Okay, so that way you understand is still very important. Then you will understand the cause. What is the cause for the children problem? So I always used to say early days, like, you know, the families which used to come to us, most of the time they used to come to us when they are, like, you know, tired and nobody is able to help them out. So that time, for them, treatment, because everybody has told them that there is no treatment. Okay, so that time when they come to us, so they are, again, they are not expecting us a treatment. They are expecting us, if somebody can help us, why this happened to my child. So that becomes a very important part, not the treatment, because they have been bombarded left and right, there is no treatment. So they also don't come to us. So they want to know why this is happening. So the testing will help in all those things, underlying cause. We say prevention of complications. So we tell that extra gene or extra chromosome, we cannot remove it, but we can take care of the complication associated with it. If you see Down syndrome children now, they are almost, I say, they are nearly normal. Okay, if you take care of the problem. If you see 20 years, 30 years back Down syndrome, they were intellectually disabled. So still, without removing that extra chromosome, we are able to treat or help the patient. So that way, and again, supportive management. So all those things we can do. And the other thing, what is important is, like this, as I told you, autism. So you can give them the speech therapy and all those things, which will help them. So then they can focus on the specialized support group. or the clinical trial which is happening. So we know there is nothing, treatment is happening, but there are a lot of clinical trials are happening. So once we know the condition, and unfortunately in genetic condition, treatment or whatever clinical trial is happening, it is not for the condition. Most of the time, what is the etiology? What is the defect? What is the mutation? On that specific mutation, what is the clinical trial? So they can be very focused to understand what is happening in the future. And another important thing is that they know what is the, why it has happened, what is the recurrences, and we can definitely prevent it for the next pregnancy.
Right.
So that is what the importance of genetic test without
testing,
going into the direct treatment. Direct treatment means removing the cause.
Okay. So, sir, basically, we can also help the pregnant mother for the next pregnancy. That is the most important thing, sir.
Yes, definitely. Definitely, yes, we can help them.
Yeah.
As I told you, we can do prenatal diagnosis.
Right. So, sir, coming into that, sir, sir, what is gene therapy, and so how can we help those people who have some certain defects in their gene or microdeletions, whatever? So
gene therapy is where you can alter the changes which is done. So you alter those
right.
things. So right now, unfortunately, in India also, gene therapy is very minimal. In India, the clinical trials
Harding
and
state.
Clinical research is very limited. So that's another point. So it is what I would like to happen, but it is something which would happen in the future, not near future, but definitely in some time.
Right.
But right now, a lot of things are happening. There are some treatment is happening for the spinal muscular atrophy. There is a Spinraza treatment is there. And DMD, some treatment is happening, treatment and clinical trials are happening. There are a lot of what you call an enzyme replacement therapy for storage disorder. But unfortunately, that we have a lot of all this treatment, very limited treatment, what is there, which is coming up. They are very costly. That is another sad side of the treatment. So, but yes, government is looking into it, and there are a lot of support group which is continuously talking to the government about, like, you know, how to make government as a policy for management. So government is looking into it, but yes, we have a long way to go. But they are helping. They are helping in so many other ways also. It can be done, but there is no central government policy which is they are drafting.
Yes, sir. Hopefully we can see something in the future. And then it
yes,
will help the people a lot. So we have two questions, and I think we can take up the questions. So one question is by M. Naveen. So it is, at which point we can start treatment based on the genetic diagnosis when the symptoms are in the initial stage of autism?
So as I told you, if you pick it up early, it is better. So if you are able to pick up those early signs of third month and all those things, so early you give the speech therapy, and that will help
the
a
milestones.
Lot. Yes. So as early if you start, like, no, from 1 year onwards, speech therapy. But if you are suspected, there is a, like, you know, two sides of the coin. Like, you know, sometimes you are overdoing, like, you know, you are looking into too many things. Or like, no, you are missing it. So you need to balance it out. It's not that everybody trying to look at it, that is not following the things, and then you straight away diagnose it as autism. So you need to balance it out, and then need to meet a speech pathologist and other team and try to understand. There are child psychologists, and there are pediatric specialists who can help you. But yes, early diagnosis, early intervention will definitely help the baby.
Okay. Thank you, sir. I hope M. Naveen has cleared his confusion. And sir, another question is by Ansar Alam. It is, what is fetal Rh blood group typing in NIPS test, and what's the clinical implications?
Okay. Now, this is one of the indications. As I told you, NIPS is nothing, that non-invasive prenatal screening. So this may help in the RH incompatibility also. But at least in I have not got any requests so far for this, but this is one of the indications or for the doing an IPS also to see the RH incompatibility.
Okay, sir. So, sir, having said everything, sir, what is the current scenario, or that is the topic for us, our discussion also today? So what is the current scenario of medical genetics in India?
So current scenario of medical genetics is very exciting. So we have a lot of optimism from two sides. One, in the genetic field, we are able to diagnose a lot of things. I won't say everything, but a lot of things. Okay, and a lot of clinical trials are happening in India also. So that is another plus point. So it is not like, you know, we used to say only everything's are happening abroad and all those things. So clinical trial for SMA and DMD is happening in India. And but yes, we have a long way to go. A lot of research need to happen in the condition what we don't know, all those things. And then the another aspect of genetic is moving into what we call is at a precision medicine. So to going into regular medicine. Okay, so regular medicine may, you know, that whatever we give treatment, it is tailored for everybody. So some treatment helps to some individual, some group of individual, some it doesn't help, and some shows a side effect. So precision medicine is going to look at the medical treatment and prevention therapies to characteristic of each patient, improving their quality of life and health outcome. So it takes into account individual differences of people's genes, environment, lifestyles, and provide clinician with a tool, a knowledge, and therapy best for the patient. So it is something like right medicine to the right person at the right dosage at the right time. So this is what we are moving into. If you see the cancer, a lot of things are happening in this direction.
Okay. So, sir, it is definitely very exciting time for us to be in, because it's also things like precision medicine. We hope it comes up very soon. So, sir, we would also like to know from you, sir, what is the future of medical genetics, like precision medicine? When can we expect these things?
So this is what I'm saying. Future is precision medicine. So it is not, I won't say it is future of medical genetics. It is the future of medicine. Okay, so everything in the medicine will slowly move into gene-based diagnosis. If you know how from the diagnosing of the common condition as a TB, which we had now moved into RT-PCR. Okay, similarly, everything, if you know the common pandemic now, our pandemic, COVID, RT-PCR. So from that, everything you are looking at the gene level. So that is going to move everything you are going to do, look at the gene level. Not only Mendelian disorder, the inherited disorder, it is moving to regular medicine also. Like another, what is one more promising thing currently is cancer. Cancer, there is a lot of things happening in the cancer and the genetics. So you have to understand cancer. Not that all cancers are familial cancer. Okay. Most of the cancers are sporadic cancers. Okay. So there also you have a genetic test and looking at the fusion, translocations, and the single nucleotide polymorphism changes and all those things. And there is a very small portion, 5 to 10% of familial cancer. If you see something like breast cancer, what we call as a hereditary breast and ovarian cancer. So that we look at the test from the blood. Okay, so we are looking at the germline mutation that is running in the family. And the other one, what we were looking at is, that is somatic mutation. So that the organ, what has got infected or the cancer. So you're looking at the gene level in that tumor or the tissue. So that, so you have a lot of things. So I can say for cancer, that in cancer, all conditions have some genetic etiology, and but all cancers are not hereditary cancer or a family cancer.
Hereditary. Right, sir. Sir, as you have said that about hereditary breast and ovarian cancer. So, sir, when can we diagnose this, and at what point will the woman present to you, or what help can you give to the women at that particular time?
So you need to understand, we are not looking at the diagnosis. Diagnosis is done by the oncologist and surgeon, by various things. So once the cancer is there, now depending upon the history and the site and all those things, you may suspect a familial cancer. So once the cancer is diagnosed, then we want to look at the cancer, whether it is familial. So we need to, important thing is we need to test the affected individual. As I told you, the familial cancers are very small, 5 to 10%. And if you break down to gene level, it is further less. So we need to have affected individual testing. It is not that you test that I have a family history, somebody passed away with breast cancer. No, we have to have the affected. Otherwise, the detection rate or identification is a challenge. So once we identify in the affected individual, then there is two things. One, we can check at-risk people. The offspring and the sibling of the person can be checked who are at risk. Then that can be tested. The challenge in the cancer and genetic is that once you have the mutation, doesn't mean that you are going to develop a cancer. So in hereditary breast and ovarian cancer, if a mother has got the mutation and if we check the daughter and daughter is harboring that mutation, doesn't mean that she will definitely get a cancer. It only means that her risk of developing cancer is further increased. So they need to have a proper surveillance. Okay, that is for the at-risk people. Now, as I told you, genetics and cancer is evolving very fast. There are something which is happening for the patient also. So once we know that it is a genetic mutation is there, there are some different immunotherapies are available, something called as a PARP inhibitor, which is there.
Yeah.
So that can help the patient. So it may help in the patient treatment also.
Okay, sir. Thank you. So, sir, having said and done everything, sir, can the common people in India afford to go for genetic testing?
See, as I told you, genetic tests are costly. But if you consider, what are we, how it is going to help, and it is going to end a lot of other testing, right, and the depth of what we are going into it, not only we are checking one gene, so we are checking multiple genes together. So that way it is, if you ask me, it is not that costly. But if you ask me, yes, it is still costly. But unfortunately, in this, what happens, all the equipments, all the reagents are costly. And it is not that, it varies from the lab or all those things. It is the equipment, everything is costly.
Costly.
But compared to what we are looking at it, and another point I always tell all the cases that when you do a testing, it is not testing for individual. That test will help the entire family.
Family.
So if you put it across like that, then it is not that costly.
Yes, sir. And besides, it would save a lot of other tests and save the money of the child a lot. And sir,
yes.
We have another question from Dr. M.K. Nayas. So the question is, in case of amniotic fluid as sample, what is relation between volume of amniotic fluid and trimester of pregnancy in case to check chromosomal abnormalities by FISH technique?
Okay, where is the relation? Volume of amniotic fluid and trimester in case to check. I am not able to follow, but amniocentesis is usually done after 16 weeks. Okay, so 16 week after that, the amniocentesis is done. And it is the sample. Now, what you want to test, as I told you, there are multiple tests are available. You want to look at the karyotyping, if you have straightforward indications, and if you are having some structural defect in the pregnancy, then you would like to do microarray. Or, as I told you, sometimes, very rare, not this thing, if you have very peculiar finding in the fetus, there is a rhabdomyoma. So rhabdomyoma is there. So then you have to, it is a very strong association of tuberous sclerosis. Then you can look at the gene for the tuberous sclerosis. Or when we have something we have to be very strongly suspecting gene level. So depending on the condition suspicion or the history, we can do the testing. But amniocentesis is done from the 16 week onwards. As I tell my all my patients, investigation is not a problem. You can investigate till the baby is going to be delivered. It is the irreversible action which you would like to take cannot be taken after 20 weeks. So that way. So sometimes in India, we are not like that. Like, no, people just want to know. Okay, we are not reached that level. So, but yes, sometimes we do in the third trimester also testing. But as I told you, counseling is very important. We need to tell the patient why we are doing testing. We are not doing testing to take irreversible action. We are doing testing to understand the, mainly for reassurance if it is negative. And if it is positive, how to manage the pregnancy. Do we need to go aggressively or whether we can take it as natural course of action like that. So it will mainly for these two reasons we have to. So the counseling is important. As I told you, testing, you can do anything.
Right. Okay. And sir, we have another question from M. Naveen, sir. What is the point in creating publicly available genetic database? How far are we, that is geneticists, in creating it, or what needs to be done to do so? And this point is with respect to Indian database.
Now, there are different points I'm not able to clear. There are different things are there. One is developing or making a registry of the conditions, okay, various conditions. So you have a registry. So we have how many cases of spinal muscular atrophy and all those things, and what are they treating, and accordingly that can be used for various purpose, for research and the thing. And the other thing, I think what I can understand, I think databases is what we are looking at, like now when we do the NGS. So we don't have, we are looking at all this polymorphism. So we don't know those polymorphism that is changing the gene variant, whether it is a pathogenic or whether it is a benign or something which we call it as a VUS, variant of unknown significance. So for that, so those polymorphism, so what we talk about usually, those polymorphism, whether certain polymorphism is there in our population, certain will not be there in the Caucasian population. So just that we need to have. So we have a long way to go. We have just in a
budding stage.
We have just created awareness about genetic condition. And then the testing is, though we have those testing, but it is not that it is available in every second lab or second hospital. Okay, so we need to do lot of thing in the investigation also. And as you are, the affordability, making it right. Cheaper. So those things. And then, yeah, obviously, in the research and treatment front, a lot of thing has to be done. So we have still long way to go. Yeah, I mean, different areas, there's so many things that need to be done.
And sir, another interesting question is there. I guess it is by Das R. What is the frequency of individuals having genomic imprinting in current practice?
Genomic imprint. That I don't think we have any carrier or any frequency for that. But those are the defect can be present or it can happen due to imprinting defect. So something goes wrong during the fertilization time so that genomic imprinting can happen. As far as I know, we don't have any carrier or the frequency what we know about. That topic itself is very complex. And I don't think so. We have a frequency. We have a lot of challenges. Okay, we don't have not that much Indian statistics also. So if you ask me about that carrier risk, the number. So number for thalassemia, as I told you, it varies. Again, it's so much wide variations are there depending upon our geographical thing from 3 to 17% to 40%, then spinal muscular atrophy, which is another autosomal recessive condition, which is very common, that is again the carrier risk is somewhere in 1 in 71. So we have a very limited information, not that much. Yes, a lot of things are happening since last 5 years, but we need to still compile all those things and think. So last few years, a lot of things are happening and we are able to identify a lot of things.
Okay. Okay, sir. And lastly, sir, I would like to ask you, sir, what would be your advice to medical students who would like to pursue the future in genetics? So what is the actual roadmap for it?
As I told you, one thing is there, like people who are coming out of MBBS, they should get more and more knowledge about genetics. Because going forward, I had checked this Robbins in pathology. It deals with a lot of genetics, karyotyping, and fish study. So it is increasing. As I told you, future is going to be, see, there are two parts. If you don't know how to read report, which is going to come now, if you see a lot of WhatsApp forwards are coming up, no, for COVID, what is that viral load and all those things. So in future, that will happen to every condition. So you need to understand the report. So you need, even if you are not in the regular, if you are not in the genetic field, so that way. So so they need to get more and more
exposure
wherever they get opportunity. One, definitely Medical Council of India or the government, which is not there, but other people need to make genetics give more importance in the curriculum. And obviously another part is the training. We don't have that much training in medical genetics. So that one's formal training. It is increasing, but still need to be done more. And if they want to pursue, but again, the students, if they get opportunity, chance to learn something in the genetics, they should try to understand. Without understanding genetic future, they will not be able to understand the electron. They will be out of, they will
the
not
future
be able
is to genetics, sir.
Yes, lot of thing. I'm hoping that it is finally happening, what I thought 20 years back. Now I am seeing something is happening in that direction.
Right. So, sir, with that, we would like to come to the end of the show. And, sir, it was an honor to speaking to you. It was really very informative, and I hope that the audience was also enriched by your session. Thank you so much, sir, for taking out time for us. And, sir, we have one or two questions if you want to take, sir.
Yeah, means if it is okay, means... For you, then
okay,
no
sir. no, sir, it's fine. We have a few questions. One question is by Ansar Alam. He has written, I think, in complicated pregnancy, go through for microarray for better diagnostic yield and also whole genome amniotic fluid. Oh, I did not get this question. Required about 25 ml in sterility. What is this? No, sir. I think he's answering to the previous.
Depending upon the indication and the gestational age, understanding the testing you have to plan. Okay. So another thing which I tell all my neonatologists, like whenever you are suspecting any very sick child or anything, just store the DNA. Okay. So that we can try to understand what is the problem in the baby. So that is one thing which we can say. That will be prenatal, depending upon the indication. There are a lot of tests are available. But whether, as I told you, as the technology is advanced, there are a lot of ambiguity is also there. So you should be clear. Pregnancy time, the information has to be yes or no. You cannot have... ambiguity about your reports. So that is one thing which you need to understand. You cannot have variant. So we don't know. The patient should not get further stressed up. As I told you, counseling is very important. testing people, a lot of awareness is happening, and a lot of labs are opening up and they're doing testing. But they're missing the point. They're missing the point of counseling, pre-test counseling. What are you doing this test for? Okay. So not that when you get into trouble, then you are looking for a counseling.
Counseling. And so if you'd like to address the elephant in the room, that is the COVID-19, sir. So if you could give in minute words, a few words, what is the relationship between COVID-19 and genetics, and how has genetics played such a big role in the early detection and mapping of the COVID-19 genes, etc.?
So what I can tell you, because of our advancement in genetics, okay, so we could sequence this virus very quickly. So that helped in two ways. Okay, one, we can understand the epidemiology. How is it changing? And this again will help in developing a vaccine. So because we are able to sequence the virus, so it helps in, otherwise if you see the earlier days, the development of vaccine and all those things took so much time. Now, because of advancement, yes, so another thing, we can sequence the gene also, which can be, if you know, RT-PCR, the detection rate is around 70%. When you sequence the gene, detection rate is 99%. But those tests are not for epidemiological study and all those things, it is good, but not as a routine testing. Because that reporting is faster. Fast reporting is required, and obviously cost is involved. But yes, because of the advancement of the thing, we are able to understand the virus very quickly. So that way it is helping in understanding virus and developing a vaccine.
Okay, sir. So, sir, with that, we would like to come to the end of this show. It was, sir, excellent, and it was very enriching for me as well, and I hope it was very enriching for the audience to be able to hear you in person. Thank you so much, sir, for joining us, and I would also like to thank Team Kacha Chronicles for giving us the opportunity to speak to Dr. Mitesh, sir.
Thank you, Samuel, and I would like to thank the Kacha Chronicle, and I hope, as I told you, that is what we are trying to create, the awareness. And Northeast, the another thing which I like, the hemoglobinopathy, we are a lot of worried about hemoglobinopathy. Northeast is a high risk area for hemoglobinopathy, HBE in combination with THAL and all those things. So I would advise to get all pregnant ladies before pregnancy itself, and if they're planning for pregnancy, to get their hemoglobin HB electrophoresis done or HbA1c done. And before all those things, because sometimes it can get into little complication also to understand the genetic cause of hemoglobinopathy. So that is one thing which I would like Northeast people to emphasize on HBE, HBS, and thalassemia.
Yes, sir, definitely. We would also try to incorporate this in our daily routine practice. Also, the cost factors also plays a little bit because, as you see.
Yes, that is one thing, but you have to understand, that is what we are saying. Government to play a bigger role. Because every test keeps adding up the cost. But yes, you have to look at the bigger picture also, because having a child with the hemoglobinopathy is a big challenge. So compared to that, this cost is very small.
Very small, definitely. Okay, sir. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Okay.